Okay. Now, the next thing, once you've prepared your pots, is you've got to figure out the appropriate space for your garden. Now, you could have, I mean, in cities, we don't really have the luxury of choice. We have whatever space we have. If there's a tall building in front of us, too bad. If we are lucky, you know, it's a south or it's a west-facing balcony and you'll be bathed in sunlight and you can consider yourself lucky. Typically, the conditions would be full sun, which means you get at least 5 to 6 hours of sunlight, direct sunlight on your pots, on your plants. Semi-shade would be where you get between 3 to 4 hours of sunlight. It may be like an east-facing balcony where you get the rising sun and the sun goes over after midday and then that's it. Or it could be a north-facing balcony, which typically would be in shade. Or if you have a really tall building in front of you, then your balcony is shaded. And you have good daylight, but you don't have direct sunlight on your plants. So these are the three conditions under which you would grow. We'll talk about what can also grow in shady balconies or terraces. But pick a spot that is preferably either full sun or semi-shade. And we will talk about what can be grown in shady conditions. So yes, what can grow in the shade? Now, if you don't have a whole lot of sunlight, you will find that it limits what all you can grow. However, there are several things that you still could grow. You can try some leafy vegetables like arugula. Spinach would also be palak. The regular palak would also sort of work. There is a kind of spinach called Brazilian spinach, also known as sisu spinach. It actually enjoys a semi-shade or pretty much a shaded condition. And it grows profusely. You can just harvest the leaves and it propagates also very fast. Some of the roots that you can grow that are also useful, you can grow haldi. Haldi leaves are also used in cooking. You can grow ginger. You can grow yam. You can grow colocasia. Colocasia is that arbi. The leaves are edible. The roots are edible. Some of the other things that are also easy to grow are black pepper. You have two kinds of black pepper. One is the vine that climbs on trees and the other is a bush pepper. And for those of us who stay in flats, bush pepper is really a very productive plant. It does not create a vine. It does perfectly fine in shaded conditions. And like a couple of pots, if they are healthy, you can pretty much get as much black pepper as you need for the year for a small family of, say, 3 or 4 people. Pineapple, surprisingly, grow really well in the shade. You can plant one pineapple plant per maybe like a 12-inch pot. And this is the season now. They'll be producing. And of course, many of you may have heard of microgreens. These don't need a whole lot of sunlight. They are short-term crops that can be harvested quickly. And so you don't really need sunlight for that. And we will talk about that down the line as well. Most shooting vegetables do tend to struggle if there is no sunlight on them. So that must be kept in mind. Okay, now we sometimes hear this question, and it's a very valid question, that why should we transplant at all? Why don't we directly put seeds into the pots or into the garden bed where we are growing? And actually, you could do that, but one of the main reasons to transplant is that we want to protect, once the seed germinates, that baby plant is actually susceptible to disease or to pest attacks. In a typical city situation, you may have pigeons that will come and pick away at the little tender leaves, or rats, or you could have any fungal problems, and these could eventually die. So to prevent that from happening, you grow them separately and you transplant healthy seedlings into pots. It's also a very efficient way to use time and water and seeds. If you put a whole lot of seeds all over, sometimes you don't know what has germinated, what hasn't germinated. So it's a great way to conserve seed, use only as many as you need. And really, it helps you pick the healthiest of the lot and put out into your garden. And it also helps you get a head start. Now, often in the rainy season, as we come to the end, September is always, you can never say when you'll get like a really heavy downpour. Last year it rained all the way till almost till December. You put out seedlings and they're so little, you know, they're fragile that if you get a big bout of rain, they'll just flatten all your seedlings. So you can start them indoors in a shaded balcony or a sheltered balcony. And when they are strong, like about 3 or 4 weeks old, you transplant out these plants and then they are much, they stand a greater chance of making it through that initial period, and you can end up with a healthy garden pretty soon. So what can we sow directly? If not everything needs to go into a nursery, there are some seeds that can and should be actually sown directly, specifically root vegetables like carrots and radish. They don't like their roots disturbed. So if you make a nursery and you pull out and you transplant, you are bound to end up with an unhealthy plant. It will only produce leaves and you'll get no roots at the bottom. So root vegetables, make sure you put them directly where they are going to grow. Also, larger seeds like beans. I have some here, like these are beans over here. Larger seeds like beans or any of the gourds, if you've seen a bottle gourd or a pumpkin seed, these are big, they're really tough seeds. And they actually, because their size is bigger, they go much lower in the soil and therefore they stand a better chance against pest and disease. And so they can be sort of sown directly also. Having said that, my preference is as long as I can do a nursery with it, I will do a nursery and I will transplant a healthy seed. So that's really how I go. Now, Karan has already gone through the different growing stages that we have. We've already done the seeds and the nurseries. We've done the soil preparation. In the next session, we will cover transplanting and, of course, growing, taking care, harvesting, and very importantly, planning the next cycle that will come thereafter. Here's a photo from my garden I took this morning. It's basically 12-inch pots with tomato plants that have been staked. They are in a pot, a semi-shaded pot. They get about 3 to 4 hours of sunlight, but they're doing pretty well, very healthy. And I just thought I'd share that with you all. Okay, over to Karan.
Thank you, Ubi. So, again, this is recapping something we talked about last time. Even as we are taking you through one stage of the garden, we need to start preparing for the next stage. So, especially since our movements are restricted at this time, it makes a lot of sense for us to take certain steps to make sure we have the right inputs available when the time to transplant and the growing stage comes along, right? So I had mentioned this before, start composting today. If you didn't start last week, you're going to need compost. It's not going to be so easy to find. We know that, you know, it's expected that we will have a lot of stores coming open from the 20th of April. Agricultural supply stores have been included in this. We hope this will mean that you shall be able to access, soil nutrients, soil itself, pots and seeds and so on more easily after that date. But in any case, it makes sense to start composting your kitchen waste and kind of just feeding it to your garden. Right. In addition, please try and collect some dry leaves. Yogita talked about mulch. I would say that it's probably the single most powerful thing to making growing your own food easy. So it just simplifies all your tasks as a gardener and saves you a lot of time and effort. So collect dry leaves from your compound wherever you can find them. These can be of different sizes. Smaller is usually easier to handle, but even if you have larger leaves, that's great. You can break them into smaller bits and pieces and kind of apply them as mulch, right? Don't burn. A lot of pollution in the cities is due to burning of different types of waste, amongst them leaf waste. So please don't, if you're in a colony which tends to burn on a regular basis, tell them not to. Use this resource, deploy it in the gardens, and of course, save yourself the pollution, right? This is how mulch is applied. In this particular case, you see we've used paddy straw as mulch, but the idea is just the same. Basically, we are trying to create a leafy blanket that covers our soil pretty much like you see in a forest. So if you walk into a forest, you will see the entire floor is covered by leaves dropped by the trees around. And this leaf litter is really the main reason that forests are forests and not deserts, right? If you didn't have all of this organic matter going into the soil, moisture being retained, microbial life being thick, you would not have such good soil in a forest, right? So borrowing this idea from nature in your garden makes a lot of sense, even if you're growing in pots. Of course, it makes sense if you're growing in the soil also, right? Here are a few ideas. So looking ahead now, assuming that you will be able to, you know, access some seeds in your neighborhoods, whether it's in Goa, whether it's in Bombay, whether it's in Bangalore or any other part of the country, here are some of the things that we would suggest you plant now, considering that we are sort of in the middle of the summer season for most places and heading into the monsoon also. So the monsoon is supposed to be, or I mean, at least the, you know, the projections seem to say it's going to be on time and it's going to be a healthy monsoon. So if that happens, these plants will kind of run through not only the summer, but also through the monsoon. Malabar spinach is one, you know, type of spinach, or Brazilian spinach. This can be grown at this time. Red amaranth or other types of amaranth can also be grown. They handle the heat reasonably well compared to some leafy greens. Cucurbits or gourds. This is a family that loves the warm weather, which thrives in the heat and later on when the monsoon comes along also. Ladyfinger, again, is, you know, like gourds, they tend to love the warm weather, fruit very quickly and, you know, become ready to harvest very quickly because of the warm weather. Long beans are also quite comfortable in the coming season, as are chilies and brinjals. Brinjals especially are interesting because, you know, they can be very productive. If you just have a couple of pots of brinjals doing well, you're probably going to have, you know, enough brinjals for yourself and the neighbors at the same time. So these are fairly productive vegetables, and some things that we would suggest that you grow in the coming months, starting now from April and going through, you know, all the way to September or so on the coast, which is when the monsoon tends to end, and even beyond that. Okay. So a quick summary of some of the things that we've talked about. As Yogita said, it is extremely important that you use the right size pots. If you use pots that are smaller than what is appropriate for the plant you're trying to grow, that's going to lead to cramped root systems or cramped plants, and that in turn is going to lead to plants that don't grow to be as productive as they might be, and tend to have lower immunity also, because they've not built up the, you know, capacity to produce food in the way that we want it to. Now, the material of your growing containers can be of different kinds. Yogita mentioned ceramic, she mentioned terracotta, plastic, and so on and so forth, grow bags and other kinds of containers. The material is actually a little less important. The size, in our opinion, is more important. Okay. Drainage is critical. A lot of people tend to kill plants by watering too much, and we have to be mindful of ensuring, we have to understand that the plants don't want to drink water. They just want soil moisture so they can sip at it a little bit from time to time, right? So those are the conditions we want to create. We don't want to overwater and cause more disease also, in addition to harming the plants. Great soil is the key to good harvest. If your soil is, you know, well made, Yogita gave you a simple recipe that, you know, really creates healthy soil. Sometimes we will take that recipe and modify it a little bit. We may add a little bit of rock phosphate to it in terms of nutrients, right? But that recipe can work with almost any kind of soil. Yeah, it can be very average soil in your compound downstairs. And what you can do is you can actually go to it. I mean, you mix it in with the coco peat and the compost, and you have very, very good soil to grow either fruits, vegetables, herbs, whatever it is you're trying to grow. And lastly, sunlight, even more than soil perhaps, is the key ingredient for growing plants that produce food. You know, while many of us may have shaded balconies, you know, unfortunately, most of the things we like to eat do require well-lit conditions. And, you know, semi-shaded is great for leafy vegetables. Full sun is preferred by fruiting vegetables. But by and large, most things that we are familiar with eating as vegetables tend to prefer fairly, you know, brightly lit conditions and direct sunlight, at least for some part of the day. Yeah. An example, you know, of things that we can grow and that grow well, you'll see pots that we have. In this case, these are 10-inch pots. with spinach growing in them, you'll notice there's just a single plant in most of these, right? Any multiple plants, I think one of the pots has two plants, that's absolutely accidental. It shouldn't be the case. One plant is completely sufficient. In the corner, you may also see a little frilly plant, edged leaf. That's a kale plant, so can grow in the same type of pots and give you a lot of leaves to harvest. That brings us pretty much to the end of what we have to plan to talk about today. I'd just like to give you a quick sense of the next session. As I said, we are going to have 5 sessions in all, taking you through the different stages of growing. Session 3 is about transplanting your seedlings into containers. So we are expecting that in another 10 days or so, maybe at the most another 2 weeks or so, your seedlings will be ready for transplant. And we will show you how this can be done a little ahead of time. We will also help you get a sense of how much to grow of which things, depending on how productive they are. So, for example, I said brinjals, if you have a couple, they are very productive. If you end up growing like 10 brinjal plants, you're going to be swamped with brinjal and never want to eat that vegetable again, right? So you need to just plan your garden to make sure that you are growing the right quantities of different things. And what we'll also do very quickly is kind of cover growing microgreens. There is a lot of interest in growing them, and therefore we'll talk about it. As Yogita said, also it doesn't require much light to grow. So even if you have a shaded balcony, pretty much in about 12 to 15 days, you can have a harvest of microgreens and keep the cycle growing. I would like to point out, though, that you have to have abundant amounts of seeds to grow these microgreens. So please, plan for this accordingly. Now, as for this session, even for the subsequent sessions, if you'd like to register, please just go to hasgeek.com/kilter/anyone-can-grow-series. The link is right here. And this is what you can use to get to the sign up page. Thank you so much for joining us. We wish you all the best in your garden. I'm Karan, and Yogita is here too. And you can write to us at info@greenessentials.in. We can also continue this conversation on Slack if you're familiar with the tool. It's a great place for you to ask questions and for us to be able to answer them. So there is a Slack channel that HasGeek has set up called friends.hasgeek.com. Just click on this link and it'll help you sign up and have access to that channel. If you're having problems, you can post photos up there and we'll respond about, what exactly, try to diagnose the problem and also provide solutions for it. If you had good experiences, with growing your nurseries at this point, please take photographs, share them with us. It'll be fun for us to see also, as for other people who have joined this session. I'll stop now and, kind of ask for questions that you may have so that Yogita and I can answer them. We'll just take a minute while the HasGeek team can kind of figure out or queue up the different questions that have been asked. In case you haven't asked any questions and would like to do so now, I'll just say again, you need to go to this Q&A tab, which will be at the bottom of your screen in the Zoom interface. And you can type in your questions over there, right? We'll kick off this AMA now. Ask away, please.
Yeah, we have a few questions which have already come in. Okay. Those who want to ask, please ask in the Q&A tab. The first question comes from Amit. He asks if there's a growing calendar for what to plant in each month in different areas of India, example, west, south, etc. So he says he's already started putting together a calendar of his own, so he wants to grow it.
Okay. What I would say is that, yes, we can create calendars. In fact, we are working on them. I think we should be done by them by this weekend. While we have coastal calendars and we have a bit for Bangalore, we were also creating another one for the north. So we'll put those together and share those in a follow-up email. Right. But let me just give you some very broad guidelines for the coming season. You would have seen that I mentioned certain plants that we could put down. I'll just go back to that slide right now just to, make it a reminder. One family that grows well right now are the cucurbits. Okay. And the cucurbits means different types of gourds. It means cucumbers. It could be bitter gourd, Karela, it could be ridge gourd, it could be, you know, a pumpkin, it could be any of this family really, you know, bottle gourd, so many others that grow and are nutritious for this time of the year. A lot of these you should put down. So look at it as a family, the cucurbit or the gourd family, and most of those will do well. They are also native. Most of these are native to India, so they do well in these conditions, the warm conditions, and then the monsoon coming a little further down the line, right? The second family that is pretty comfortable is what I would call the solanaceous family. So this is chili, brinjal, both of which you see here. Tomatoes also, though they won't do so well once the monsoon comes around. Tomatoes are a little susceptible to fungal diseases, and high humidity and water availability tends to cause that, right? The next family that you want to grow is the beans, not the French beans, but the long beans, right? The French beans prefer cooler weather, but the long beans and the cluster beans do well even in warmer climates, which is what we are experiencing now and will for the next couple of months. So that's something else that you should grow. Other than this, ladyfinger loves the heat again, and it should be planted right now, will grow for you for the next 4 or 5 months and produce quite a bit also. Leafy vegetables tend to struggle a little bit, like lettuce, for example, just won't grow at this time of the year. Many of the mustards will also experience aphids, you know, especially when humidity gets a little high. So we tend to limit the amount of leafy greens that we grow at these times, but still you can grow red amaranth. You can also grow arugula, you know, to some extent, or rocket as a leafy vegetable. You can grow Malabar spinach, which is a very vine-like growing kind of leafy vegetable. So all of these are things that you can look to grow in this coming season. As I said, we will create more detailed calendars and put them up in the next summary email, so sort of email that we send out to you. You should be able to access them for your region.
Okay. We have a few questions from Joy Ghosh. The first one is about the plants that he's tried growing in his balcony. Most of his seedlings have turned out to be very curvy. Is that because of the sunlight or is that something else?
Yes, yes, yes. So we call them leggy. When the seedlings are, I mean, the stem is not firm and therefore they tend to be bending over usually towards the light, right? They tend to be a little weak. So I'm not sure how your house is, but if you have a sunnier, even a ledge or something like that, perhaps a window on the other side, you will immediately see, if you just leave it out there for a week, you will suddenly see that these perk up and do very well. Or I know it's tricky at this time, but if, you know, a neighbor on the other side can just hold the seedlings for you, they'll be good, healthy seedlings by the time you get to the end of the 3 week period, which most seedlings take to get ready.
Okay. The next question is again from Joy. He asked if there's any watering method to follow if one is traveling for a few days and they're not able to water the plants themselves.
Okay, so I'll just... Yogita, would you want to take this one? One sec. Huh? I just need to activate Yogita's...
There are different things you can do when you're traveling. Like if you're traveling for 3-4 days, there are ways in which you can address that. Like many pots come with a little base plate. And if you have a slightly larger base plate, like even this big steel plate, you can fill it with water. And the water through capillary action will sort of keep going up at the root level. The soil and the roots will sort of be able to access that water. You may fill it up till... I don't know, maybe halfway through this plate or something. But you need several of such plates to put your pots in. And they would last typically 3-4 days. But if you're going out for a longer period, it may be difficult. And that is a challenge that many of us who live in flats have. Either we can then leave a key with a friend who can come and do the watering, or a neighbor or something like that. But that is one way. Once I had done this, it's a little intensive, but it worked. You know, you get these saline drip bags, and there is you don't have a needle, of course. You remove the needle, but you can set the dripper. It basically becomes a drip thing. So you leave a bag full of, I don't know, they usually are 500 ml or whatever, and you can have that slowly drip at the root level. But it's not something you can scale up tremendously, otherwise your house will look like a hospital. You could also, my grandmother used to do this. She would take a cloth and she would sort of put that in a big bucket of water, or she had strips of, you know, slightly thickish cottony cloth, and she dipped them in the bucket of water, and the bucket would be slightly at an elevation, and then she sort of put them under a little bit of the soil for a while. So again, through that capillary action, there would be a sort of flow created and you'd get a little moisture there. You know, there are many things you can try. You'll have to see. You could, if the plant is like a fruiting tree, even put it in your bathroom and leave the tap on very little so that drop by drop by drop it happens. It may not like the fact that there's no sunlight, but at least it'll get water. And if you're back in 3-4 days, you can quickly bring it back out where it gets the sun and it'll sort of perk up again. So there are a few things you can do. But if you're gone for a long period, then you've got to sort of make arrangements like you would for a pet, for someone to come and water your plant.
Yeah, I'd just like to add to this, and I'd like to say that if you, you know, notice the soil that we've created, by adding coco peat, we've considerably sort of increased the carrying capacity, the water holding capacity of the soil. So this soil will do much better for you than the typical red clayey soil that, you know, you get from many nurseries or in which your plants normally come, right? So, you know, if you take the example of the 3-4 days that Yogita was suggesting, I think you would be able to carry pretty well through three or four days as long as you watered deeply and well before you left. The second tool that we've kind of used to address this issue and which will serve you well, I remember a time, I think, that we were away for almost 3 weeks and we had basil continue to do well in that period of time simply because the soil was very well mulched, right? So if you mulch the soil, you leave this blanket of 2 inches or so of leaf waste on top of your soil, it prevents the wind from blowing away the moisture and retains moisture for a much longer period of time. So think of these as also improvements which will help you in those situations.
Okay, moving on to the next question. If we are transplanting using cuttings instead of seedlings, what are the steps that we have to follow?
Would you like to take that? Okay.
I think one of the things you need to get right is that you should take the right cutting. Some plants will only propagate if the cutting is woody. For example, mulberry, you'll have a woody stem and then you'll have a fresh green shoot. If you try and root the green shoot, nothing will happen. And that's true for many plants. So, you know, a quick search online for the specific plant that you're trying to propagate via cutting will tell you what kind of a cutting you should take. Also, if you see any cutting, you'll find like on your finger, you have these lines. You have points that are called nodes. Now, the node is from where either a shoot appears or a root appears. Typically, what I do is I make sure that when I'm rooting a cutting, I put at least 2 nodes in the soil so that there is a greater chance. So if you have a longer stem and it's possible, you can even put 3 nodes. That just increases the chances of the roots coming out from one of those 3 nodes, and then you need to have maybe two or three nodes on top. I typically tend to strip the leaves. For example, if it's pudina or common market mint, I strip all the bottom leaves. I just leave like maybe 4 or 5 leaves on the top, and then I directly root it in soil. You can also root some of these things in water, but I found that soil is just as effective, and it saves you one step. So directly goes into a moist pot and you keep watering it regularly and it sort of propagates from there. So cuttings are a great way to propagate plants, and it's sort of a shortcut. You don't have to go through the whole cycle. It also reminds me, if you're growing tomatoes, you'll have like the main tomato stem, you'll have a branch that will come through, and often between the main stem and the branch, you'll have another like a tertiary thing poking out. If you allow it to grow, it sort of distributes the food and you don't want that. Normally, we end up pinching that. But if you allow it to grow to, say, maybe 4 inches or so, 5 inches or so, you break it and you root it, you immediately get another tomato plant. So that saves you 21 days or 28 days of sowing and you know, germinating and then transplanting, you can straight off start a new plant from those shoots that come in the middle. So that's a tip I thought you might find interesting.
Okay. The next question is about a failed attempt at growing sort of sprouting coriander seeds and chilies. So Devaki had tried sprouting a few seeds in tissue paper inside a airtight plastic food container, sprinkling a little water every 2 to 3 days, but it just would not sprout. What could be the reasons behind this?
Okay, so the first thing that is possible is
I think Karan, you're on.
Yeah. So the first reason this could happen is because the for some reason the quality of the seeds that you have is not very good. Maybe they are seeds that have been kept for a while and therefore have lost their vitality. They do not germinate, right? Typically, if you've got the description, I mean, just hearing the description of what you've done, it should have sprouted by this amount of time. Usually, it will take between 5 to maybe 8 days to sprout and not much more than that. That's the most likely thing as far as I can see. In the case of coriander, however, I just like to point out something else. Coriander seeds are usually more hardy than the example of chili that you said, simply because it is like a compound seed. It actually has two compartments and you have seeds in each of those compartments. But one of the things is because it has such, in a sense, robust packaging, what you have to do is you have to actually take the seeds, put them maybe in a hanky, in a cloth of some sort. Then you kind of fold the cloth over and then you rub and press them over so that the packaging actually cracks. So the pods kind of open up and the seeds come out and then those seeds are easier to germinate. So I'm not sure whether you did that for the coriander, but that could be one other reason why it doesn't work. I'd also like to point out at this time that there is a good way to keep your seeds. That is to ensure that your seeds are doing well for a longer period of time. First thing is that seeds don't like being stored in the heat and sunlight. So for sure, you want to put them in the shadiest portion of your house. Now, depending where you're located, sometimes we have a lot of humidity, example being either the east or the west coast of India. Coastal regions have high humidity through a good part of the year and experience the monsoons when, of course, they are at their highest. These can really undermine the quality of your seeds. So what we do is we take our seeds, we put them in a sort of a small self-sealing packet. I'll just take an example and show you something like this. I'm not sure if I'm showing up as the spotlight video, but hopefully now you can see this. I'll stop sharing.
Just give me you have to stop sharing this.
Yeah, okay. So can you see this packet? So if you see, we take a self-sealing bag like this. And one of the things that we try to do is we try to squeeze out all the air before we seal it off. So in that way, air with moisture is not trapped inside. And the seeds will stay for a longer period of time. Now, what we will typically do is, let's suppose I have about 5 or 6 seeds packets like this. We will put it in a larger self-sealing bag. And we will seal that off too. And we will put it in the refrigerator, typically near the door, not towards the back of the refrigerator or, you know, in the crisper tray or the, especially not in the freezer, right? So you just want to keep it somewhere near the door where the temperature is not too low and where the humidity is likely to be less. And we found that seeds will stay for a couple of years even, if they are stored well in this way. So hopefully that's a tip for the future that can be useful. As I said, if you use seeds that you brought from somewhere, they may have gotten older, or perhaps if these were seeds that you harvested from what was lying around the kitchen, they were not particularly effective. That seems to be the major reason why I think, I mean, that seems to me the reason why they've not worked well for you.
Okay, we have one last question in the Q&A tab. Are there any thumb rules for when to water and how much?
So Yogi, you would like to take that?
As a thumb rule, I mean, busy city people water when you get time. But try and be consistent. It's like a pet likes to be fed at the same time, more or less on a daily basis, if you are watering daily. If your soil is able to hold water, you don't need to water daily. So here is what I do. This is, you've seen how I prepare soil. I can typically skip a day because the soil holds enough water because of all the organic matter that's gone in and because of the mulch. So I don't water every day. It is ideal to water in the second half of the day. You know, you water in the evening, that water remains in the soil through the evening, through the night, and up to the morning when the sun comes up and it starts the drying process. If I water first thing in the morning, even if it's early, by the time the sun is up and it's 10 and 11, the water starts evaporating. So the function of water in soil is basically to have the interchange of nutrients and all the minerals that are there. That's what the water is used for. So if it's there longer, it means that the plant can do that on a more frequent basis. So that's one thing. The other thing is, when you water, water deeply. Don't just water the top and just, you know, the top 2 inches of the soil will get wet. And then again, you have to water. So if you water deeply, if you water so that the water, you see the water coming out from the bottom of the container, what that means is that the entire column of soil is moist. It also encourages then the roots to grow all the way to the bottom. A common thing that happens with brinjal plants is that once the fruit comes, the plant becomes pretty heavy on top. And if it's not well rooted, your plant will just tend to keel over. And then you've got to stake it, and that's a problem in itself because you may end up poking the roots and that kind of thing. So when you water, water deeply. It's preferable to water in the evening so that the water stays there longer. And most importantly, check the soil. You know, check and see if it looks moist. Skip a day. Don't just water every day because you think you need to water every day. Check and see if the soil, and your plants will tell you, like, here this plant is looking nice and perky. If it needed water, it would be all droopy and it would look sad. So it will sort of indicate as well. You don't have to always wait for them to droop, but you'll get a sense of it. Those are like indicators to see. So check, put your finger in. If it feels moist, totally skip a day. Skip 2 days if you know, if it's during the monsoons, you'll find that even though you are at the edge of a sheltered balcony, it'll catch the spray. And you may find that you don't need to water for 3 days at a time. So that's also good. I hope that answers your question.
Okay, I think we've answered all the questions that have come in. If anybody else has any questions, please do share it on YouTube, Facebook, on the Zoom link. We have a bit more time to take questions, or if you'd like to share your experiences growing, please raise your hand in the participants panel and you can share your experiences.
So this is pretty much the end of our session for today, and I hope you found it useful. Perhaps we can just put up the poll about how useful you found it, and it would be great if you can respond. Yeah, okay. So this is a poll which asks about what it is that you would like to learn. I'd really appreciate it if you can take the time to record your sort of feedback here, because we'd be interested in looking at it and deciding what we should cover in subsequent sessions or what to give more time and attention to, certainly. Thanks. I can see several of you have given your feedback to us.
We have one more question in chat that's just come in.
Sure.
Viraj asks if you could speak a little bit about the pests that affect some of the plants that you've talked about today.
Okay, so I'll answer that in two or three parts. First thing, if we are doing the right things vis-a-vis the environment we create for our plants, and if you are doing things, the right things related to our soil and the care of the plants, then frankly, pests are just a footnote. Now, I know it's something that most new gardeners are really worried about, pests and about disease. And, you know, it's quite disheartening to see when your plants that you've tended to suddenly seem to fall sort of victim to some kind of problem and, you know, keel over or die or just do poorly, right? I'd like to then go on to say that, yes, in an organic system, we do have to deal with pests as with any other system, but our approach is very different. If you look at chemical-based pest management, that typically means using poison to kill, you know, whatever pest you're experiencing. The type of poison is fairly generic in the sense it tends to be the same irrespective of the pest that you're dealing with, right? So that's a sort of a, if I can call it, well, it seems the wrong word to use when you're using poison, but it is a curative approach, right? Now, what we try to do in organic growing systems is we try to have a less, not a curative, but a preventive approach to growing. The first thing that you do in terms of design of your garden is make sure that you don't grow too much of one thing. So diversity is one principle that we kind of address. And I would like to point out that we will talk about this in detail in subsequent sessions, which is why I'm going to just go over it very briefly. The second thing that we try to do is we, after ensuring diversity, is we try to get a sense of which pests we are likely to experience. So I give you an example on the disease side where I said fungal diseases are very common in places along the coast or any place with high humidity, right? So that's one kind of thing. When this kind of combination of heat and humidity, like warm weather and humidity happens, the most common pest you will experience is what we call aphids. Okay, so these are little sucking pests which happen under the leaf. They usually typically at the, you know, on the underside of the leaf, and they don't have wings. They don't move around. Sometimes you will also see ants. While the ants don't harm your plant at all, they kind of use these sucking pests to extract the sap and consume it themselves, right? So aphids are one problem, and the way to deal with them would be to not congest your space. If you stick too many plants too close together, humidity tends to get trapped inside those kind of spaces, and you will have more incidence of aphids. So that's one way to deal with them. Another technique that we use is to repel insects purely by creating unpleasant circumstances for them. So it's like when you don't want a neighbor to come over, right? You just make sure that he knows that he's not welcome. And if you have a nice, strong, overpowering smell, it works for a lot of insects because they have very sensitive olfactory systems, right? So cow urine, which is really stinky, I don't know how many of you have used it, is brilliant to do that in a way. Neem is another one. It's a very bitter kind of a taste and smell. So that tends to be a deterrent too. Quite often we will use wood ash, which is this smell, the burning texture and smell of ash will deter a lot of pests, right? But remember that in organic systems, you don't just blanket apply these. You first try and observe and see which pest is it that I am kind of experiencing, and then respond based on that. A couple of other common pests that one might experience. So with the gourds, there are these kind of cucumber beetles that tend to be very common, or fruit flies, a certain kind of fruit flies, cucurbit fruit flies that are common. Now, the cucumber beetles can tend to be, the fruit fly I think is the more common, and therefore I'll talk about that. It tends to lay an egg inside the fruit when it's very small, when the flower is becoming a fruit. And then as the fruit grows, this tends to hatch, the egg hatches, and the larvae tends to do something in terms of sort of causing a problem, right? So the larvae will then sort of hatch and eat its way out, and therefore spoil the fruit itself. Okay, so we use different systems. Basically, they're called pheromone traps, LDOs. They are used to deal with these and reduce populations of this nature. Then another common pest is something called thrips. Now, thrips looks like a tiny, like fluorescent green mosquito, which is usually on the plants on at dawn and dusk when the light is low. That's when you can usually see it. Through the day, you might not notice it. But basically what it does is it seems to scrape the surface of the leaves of plants like ladyfinger, brinjal, which we talked about, also perhaps chili. And the texture of the leaf becomes very, it looks very scarred and bumpy. And that's really, that affects, you know, how much processing of food the leaf can do, and therefore the health of the plant itself. So these are common press. In order to deal with thrips, we use sticky traps quite often. There is a blue colored sticky trap which attracts thrips. There is a yellow colored sticky traps which also can deal with aphids. So we just use different tools at different times, right? We will in future, once we've explained many of the techniques of handling pests organically, also create a, share with you a sheet that we have which describes many of the solutions. Sorry for the long-winded answer, but it's a complicated question when it comes to organic growth.
We have one more question actually from Devaki.
Sure.
So she started growing mustard and fenugreek seedlings after the last week's session. She's asking how deep the pot for transplant should be.
So
mustard being a leafy vegetable, I think an 8-inch pot depth should be fine. Methi, I would not transplant. Methi, I would let it be where it is. And, you know, as they grow, because methi, firstly, is a more or less a winter crop. I don't know where you are, Devaki, and what your climate is right now. But let them grow to pretty much, I would say, like a microgreen or maybe a little older, and then I would harvest it. So it will be really tender methi, because if it's very warm, it will grow, it will germinate, it will come to the point of microgreen, and then it will sort of start yellowing, or it will, you know, collapse. So don't transplant methi. Let it grow in the container it is. And you could have multiple containers of methi. Methi grows really fast. So you could have several small ones and you can snip them and harvest them. Once you snip and harvest, it will not come back. So you will have to put down more methi seeds. But an 8-inch pot, that is the size of this pot, for a mustard would be fine. This is also a mustard I have growing in here. Actually, it's in a dahi container. It's growing quite well. And I just put it in a ceramic container so it looks all pretty, you know. But yeah, you can use recycled containers like that, and you can have several plants, single plants growing in each of these. Even in an 8-inch pot, I would put only one. Because when these plants become full size, their spread would be almost a foot. So if you cannot put two plants, they will compete at the root level for nutrition and they will not be as productive. So one plant per 8-inch pot, or even like that's a smaller one, can do. But this gives it its full potential of growth.
Among, I'll just ask for you to put up the last poll. Folks, we'd like some feedback. Did you find this useful? Have we done a good job? Was it worth your while? So if you can just rate us on the session from 5 to 1, depending on your experience in this, I'd be grateful. While we wait for results to come in, I'll also mention a couple of other resources that may be helpful. First, about 3 years ago, I think, we started the Seed Store. It's an online store where you can buy vegetable seeds. We started it because people would keep asking us where you could get good seeds. We are not able to ship right now, but assuming in the next week or two, courier services start working well, perhaps May onwards, you can, you know, go to the site, search for different types of seeds you may be interested in, and try growing them too. We focus a lot on germination rates because, I mean, that was the first thing that we were sort of disturbed by when we first started growing. We also have grown most of the things that we offer here for at least 5 to 8 years. So we know that they work very well in Indian climates, not just in warmer climates, but all across India. So I just wanted to point that out as a resource that you may find useful, right? Some of you may need, advice on how to grow that is more involved. Maybe you'd like to have one-to-one conversations or things like that. My phone number is here. Just WhatsApp me and we can get in touch, and perhaps we can set up a system for us to sort of regularly guide you in a more close way than is possible through a session through this. So please do get in touch with me if you would do that. That pretty much brings us to the
end. Karan, we have a couple more questions that have come in.
Okay. Sure. No problem.
Satish from Bangalore asks, how do you deal with leaf miners on tomato plants?
Okay. Yes, a common pest that I should have mentioned. I think we answered this to some extent in the last session. So Satish, leaf miner, first let's just understand it. It's an insect that we see more in the cities. It lays an egg in your leaf, and once this egg hatches, the insect, the young insect tries to exit the leaf, but doesn't do it vertically, it does it horizontally. So it goes in this crazy winding sort of path, trying to reach the edge of the leaf through which it can exit, right? The leaf also provides it a certain amount of food in that period of time. So the best way to deal with it is not after the egg is already hatched, it's before the egg is even laid, right? So what we want to do is we want to have preventive sprinklings of either neem or neem diluted or potash or other, sorry, wood ash, which we can sprinkle on the leaves, which makes it unpleasant. And you can use diluted cow urine also. Just remember, when we say sprays, typically we mean a 10% solution, which means you take, say, neem oil or something like that, and you actually dilute it in water, where 1 liter of water would have about 100 ml of neem oil. Just not that you need those quantities, but perhaps you need just 100 ml. So you would use 10 ml of neem oil, right? That's the best way to deal with leaf miner, to actually prevent the laying of the egg itself by making the leaves a little bit inhospitable for the insect.
He also asks if you'll be speaking about hydroponics at any time in the series.
I'm sorry, hydroponics is a little out of our area of experience. While we are very familiar with, you know, the hydroponic systems, and while we have a lot of friends who are involved in it, since our focus had always been on organic growing, and hydroponics to the greatest extent requires certain chemical nutrients, we never adopted that system. So I'm sorry, but we know a lot about the biology of the plants you can use for hydroponics, but the growing system itself is something that we probably wouldn't be the best people to ask.
Yeah, I think that's pretty much it.
Okay, great. So thanks so much. This brings us to the end of the session. Thanks for those of you who have taken the time to be here. I hope it was useful. I hope you learned something from it, and I hope you can use this knowledge in the coming weeks. We will have another session, just going back to what I told you, on the 23rd of April, which is the next Thursday. And what we'd be covering is transplanting of seedlings into containers. We talk about how much to grow and of what, and also about growing microgreens. So we can also, in the questions Q&A section at the end, address any new situations that you've come up with. I think Devaki had many questions from the last session. So if as you move ahead and you have more questions, we'd be happy to answer them in the next session also. Thank you so much for your time, everybody. And thanks so much, Amog, Anish, Zainab, for all the help organizing this session. You've made it quite easy for us. And it's been great fun to do.
Thanks, everyone. Hope to see you next week again.
Thank you, Karan. Thank you, Yogita.
Okay. Bye-bye. Good day.
Bye. Bye.